this becomes all the more important, services liberalization, because of what is called servicification of the manufacturing sector. Recent research shows that most of the manufacturing exports, 25% value added is services. Then in developed countries, manufactured exports, nearly 35% value added is services. So servicification is equally important. Finally, the investment challenge is that South Asia needs to take the trade investment nexus into consideration. That is how you can boost trade via investment. ASEAN did it by various arrangements, joint ventures with buyback arrangements, vertical integration of industries, and SAARC has this investment protection and promotion agreement and time to expedite the implementation of that. So the way forward is basically there are a lot of opportunities, but there are impediments. Overcoming the impediments is the challenge, and that challenge SAARC has to meet head on. Of course, we have the asymmetry of the region, with India being the largest player, whether it is in terms of GDP, land area or population, but then India has to do something additional to get win the confidence of the other SAARC countries, and then the other SAARC countries can reciprocate to India's gestures and strengthen the regional integration process so that the entire region benefits from trade and integration region in the coming years. I thank you.
Thank you very much indeed to Dr. Kodanama for that comprehensive overview of the challenges and opportunities facing SAARC countries if they are to overcome the significant impediments that he outlined. Now, I'd like to introduce our session chairman, who is Dr. Miftah Ismail. He's the MOS and Special Assistant to the Prime Minister, the Chairman of the Board of Investment. He holds a PhD in public finance and political economy from the Wharton School of Business. As a professional economist, he worked at the IMF before returning to Pakistan. He has a proven track record of leading at the forefront of economic policy, and he has an illustrious biography, which is available in the app, which you can download. I couldn't do justice to it in such a short time, but I invite you, Dr. Miftah Ismail, to give your concluding remarks and conduct the Q&A for this session. Thank you.
Mr. Naeem Akhtar Sheikh, President of SAFA, Mr. Vekatis Mordul, Dr. Saman Kalagama, Assalamu alaikum, good morning. My task is to talk to you about investment opportunities and challenges in this region. Since unfortunately I don't know too about the rest of the countries in this region, I'll speak to you mostly about Pakistan. But I think many of the lessons that are important for Pakistan apply to other regions as well. Ladies and gentlemen, as you know that in Pakistan you actually had, except for maybe a few years in the 1960s, you really had a low growth economy. And since the 1960s growth spurts, we've actually grown a little bit in spurts in the 80s and 90s. But we really haven't had, you know, the fast economic growth that East Asian countries have seen. And that applies also to a lot of South Asian countries who have not really grown very fast over the years, over the decades, compared to the rest of the East Asian counterparts. And that's why we lag behind not just human development indicators, but a lot of financial indicators and economic indicators. And this is particularly unfortunate in the case of Pakistan, because we really have all the ingredients, or we have almost all the ingredients required for high growth. If we start talking about, if you think about this, in terms of natural resources, Pakistan is exceptionally blessed with huge amounts of natural resources. For instance, in the Thar Desert, we have 180 billion tons of coal. That at $50 a ton is about $9 trillion worth of coal. It's a huge amount of resource, fifth largest coal resource in the world. And to this day, I mean, only a few months back, first time in the history of Pakistan, we just actually started mining that coal, but we've actually not touched that coal. It's always been in ground. So it may be the fifth largest deposit in the world. It may be valued at $9 trillion, but it's all, you know, just underground. Similarly, we have also the fifth largest copper deposits in the world. The area in Balochistan where we have copper deposits is 30,000 square kilometers, which is comparable to the area in Chile. And Chile has, for instance, 7% of GDP coming out of copper mining, and Pakistan only has less than 0.1% of its GDP coming out of oil mining. So again, you have huge resources like copper, but there is no point of it because we've not been mining it. Similarly, we also have one of the highest, in fact, top 10 deposits of iron ore in Pakistan. So we have a lot of minerals and mining resources in Pakistan that we've not really utilized. But these mining resources are there and ready to be utilized. And as I said, we just started coal mining. On the Indus cascade alone, we can produce more than 60,000 megawatts of electricity. And the water that we have actually goes into this canal that we have, 40,000 kilometers long canal that we have in Sindh and Punjab, which renders a huge area of Pakistan irrigated around the year. And that's why we are the top 10 producers of wheat, cotton, milk, and I think the 11th biggest producer of rice in the world. So we are blessed with a lot of natural resources without a doubt in Pakistan. And we also are blessed with huge human resources as well. We have, as you all know, the population of at least 180 million people, of which 60 million people can be classed in middle class, classified in middle class. By 2025, we will have 100 million people in the middle class, which will render us the fifth largest middle class in the world, able to afford a middle class lifestyle, able to buy consumer goods, consumer durables, fast moving consumer goods and the like. So this huge middle class that we will have, we already have it by 2025, we have, will be so attractive to global players or global manufacturers that wherever you are in the world, and if you have global ambitions and you are a global manufacturer, you would want to be in Pakistan, you would want to set up shop in Pakistan, you would want to either produce in Pakistan or export to Pakistan or buy from Pakistan, because by being the fifth largest middle class in the world, we become the inevitable market. And the market is so large that it would allow the manufacturers in Pakistan to set up a large-scale industry, reducing their cost of, you know, production. And when they reduce their cost of production, they can export out of Pakistan as well. So Pakistan's large size of the population actually renders us very competitive in terms of exports as well. So you have these huge human resources, the young demographic, you know, a young demography in Pakistan. We have huge natural resources, and yet still we have not really been able to grow as fast as we want to over the years. And I primarily think that's because we've actually not had good economic management. But fortunately now I think we've turned the tide and our economic management improved. Since Prime Minister Nawaz has taken over the reins of government in Pakistan, we've been able to bring down budget deficit, for instance, from 8.2% to 4.3%, I think this will be this year. Our GDP is at 4.25%, which is the highest we've had in 8 years. Our deficit, I told you, our debt to GDP ratio is actually moving in the right direction. We're actually reducing our debt to GDP. And I think hopefully when we finish our first term in 2018, we will have come very close to the mandated 60% debt to GDP ratio. Our interest rates and inflation rates are also at historical lows. And our foreign currency deposits are at historical highs. So we've actually done stabilization of macroeconomic indicators, and now I think it's time that we can grow our economy. And with the human resources that I told you about and the natural resources that we all know about, I think that with sound management, there's nothing that's stopping us from growing, except maybe what my good friend Mr. Arun is sitting here. And he'll tell you about the taxation growth that we actually had. And how that has also helped our fiscal structure. So there's growth that is inevitable in Pakistan in the coming years. So what are the investment opportunities in Pakistan? Well, I'll tell you just a couple of things. I told you that in Karachi Stock Exchange, and now the Pakistan Stock Exchange, in the last 15 years has grown at more than 25% a year in dollar terms. If you set up a power plant in Pakistan, a power generation plant in Pakistan, or if you set up power distribution company in Pakistan, or transmission line in Pakistan, the government of Pakistan gives you at least a 17% return on investment. At least a 17% return on investment. In practical terms, many of these companies actually make about 25-30% return on investment. So huge return on investment from government mandated